Uhtred, son of Uhtred, Lord of Bebbanburg. It's time you remembered that.
From Providence, Rhode Island, welcome to The Last King with blah, 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 Kingdom with Miriam Blake, the podcast dedicated to The Last Kingdom on Netflix. So let's sit back, relax, and see how England was born.
My name's Blake, and if that is not proof that we don't record that intro every single time, then I don't know what to tell you.
Honestly. And just for those of you who don't know, I am sleep deprived. So there we go.
Even the most amount of coffee in this world is not going to save you today.
Not today.
No, it's okay.
Between all sorts of things keeping me up the past several weeks, I'm running on fumes, friends, but I'm here to talk about one of the most impressive episodes of The Last Kingdom. Really, really pumped about this. Now, remember, for those of you who found us in the podcast, make sure you hit that subscribe button. For those of you who watch us on our social media channels, find us in your podcast app anyway. Give us a subscribe. Leave us a little review, particularly in Apple Podcasts. And those of you at jointhenerdclan.com, you made this podcast possible. Like, you voted on this. So if you're new to Mary and Blake and you're like, I'm digging this, I love The Last Kingdom, I want to, you know more about these two,
sure,
you can head to maryandblake.com. We have loads of podcasts there. We actually have a Facebook community for our listeners. Just search Mary and Blake on Facebook. It's the only group named Mary and Blake. You'll be able to find it. And if you want to make a difference in our company, you can head to jointhenerdclan.com. I'm going to put a call out to you right now. We are in dire need of getting a new computer. It's been causing a lot of difficulties, which has kind of jumbled up our recording sessions. So just know that all of you at jointhenerdclan.com make a difference. And if you want to join, you can join for as little as $2 a month. All right, let's get into the show.
All right, let's do it. Nope, that was the wrong one, Blake.
I'm not the only one.
Oh my goodness gracious, we are like all over the place today. All right, okay. Let's do the real one this time.
All right, there we go.
Gotta hit the right button, Blake.
You know, I think we're also just so frazzled after this episode. This episode just took you in the ways that we're used to, and seeing Uhtred in a way that we're used to, and completely threw us for a loop.
Oh yeah.
It was quite a doozy of an episode. And Blake, you were saying that a lot of people say that this is the episode that made them fall truly in love with The Last Kingdom, that this is when things really turn in an epic way. So if you have been just a casual viewer, you said that this is the one that makes people be like, all right, I need to really binge this show.
Yes, all right, so let's put a sword in that conversation.
Okay.
Because I want to get to the details, and then okay, we'll talk about it.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So this is episode 3 of season 2. We are almost halfway through. At the end of this episode, Mary, we are halfway through season 2.
Okay.
So something big is probably coming here. We'll see what that is. Mm. We'll see what that is. But episode 3, director was by John East. You probably don't know that name because he's got a lot of British television.
Okay.
But he has broken into some American television as well. We have here Downton Abbey all the way back in 2013.
Mm-hmm.
Killing Eve in 2018. Whiskey Cavalier. He directed Lost in Space, the television show Cursed, and most recently directed the television show Pennyworth, which is on HBO Max. It's part of the whole DC universe.
Okay.
So that's that. The writer was Ben Vanstone. Also, a lot of British television, TV shows like The Borrowers, The Smoke, You, Me, and the Apocalypse, obviously The Last Kingdom, The English Game, and All Creatures Great and Small.
Hmm.
He also does another television show as well as John East. Together, they also took part in the show of the EastEnders. So consider that if you liked the work that was done in this episode, those are the guys behind it.
Interesting.
Also, worthy of note, first episode not written by Chris Bouchard.
Ooh.
First episode.
Interesting that this was it.
Yeah, so that does get you into the conversation of the auteur conversation, mm-hmm. right? Is it better to have somebody or have a couple of people writing television scripts for one show? Or is it better to have just one single writer?
Yeah.
I think an argument could be made either way.
I would agree. I found this to be quite a good episode.
You know, if you look at something like True Detective, you know, mm-hmm. you have one guy doing the whole thing.
Yep.
Or if you have a show like Outlander, a bunch of mm-hmm. people, men and women, writing these episodes. And in this particular case, now we finally have one guy making his way into the writer's form. Yep. So it's an interesting conversation, something that I think we all should consider as listeners and as watchers. What do we like most? We'd love to hear your thoughts.
Agreed.
Okay, Marvin, your Shields rating. How many Shields are you giving this episode?
I'm going to give this episode a whopping 4.9. I was riveted. I was really there. I had a lot of moments where I was like, yes, yes, yes. Or at least I applaud what you're doing, or I hate what you're doing so much, but I'm here for it. And then there was something that I didn't like. So, how about you?
I would say, Mary and I, you and I are equal.
Oh my gosh, in this we're married.
I know. Here's what I will say. It was a great episode. Though, this show mm-hmm. has made its bones in chewing through time and chewing through long periods of time.
Whole seasons. Whole halves of a year.
Literal seasons.
In one episode.
And the episode was great. But I kind of wanted it to slow down. Mm-hmm. I kind of wanted this whole process to be at least two episodes.
Yep.
And that's why I'm giving it a 4.9. Because other than that, it was a great episode.
Cool.
All right, Marvin, your GBGs. What do you got for your good, bad, and your great?
My good, my bad, my great. All right. So my good is just how I've really enjoyed seeing Uhtred evolve in this episode. You know, I've been saying frequently that, like, I like him. I'm kind of rooting for him, but I don't love him. I need to see more of a bigger character arc. This was it. I can see how everyone was saying, way to get to season two, episode three. This was amazing. You know, we've seen him go through so much pain, losing different people. And I feel like the pain that he has with Hellig, is that his friend?
Hellig.
Whatever, that guy, dead guy. it gels together. So I'm here for the Uhtred storyline, which...
Oh, okay. Look at you.
My bad. It's a dual bad. Even though this is only 4.9, it's a dual bad because they're minuscule things that I was like, ugh. First off, it's the previously on the last episode of The Last Kingdom.
Sure. Oh, okay. I know what you're talking about.
It starts off like, I'm Uhtred, son of Uhtred. I fell in love with the king's sister.
Yeah.
Whatever.
So, no, you didn't.
Like... What? No, I did. I yelled out. No, you didn't. You just had sex last episode. Like, you can't say every single person that you have sex with, you fall in love with. You know what I mean? Uhtred, like, calm down. You got to know each other a little bit. You got to make some, like, life plans, see how your values line up.
Is Uhtred a stage 5 clinger?
He is a serial monogamist.
Yes, I think so.
I mean, but then again, he was, like, kind of sleeping in the barn while he was married. Anyway, he just he needs to always have someone who he's in love with, and he keeps trying to hit on Hild. Stop hitting on Hild, okay? Yeah, she's not your woman. Anyway, but yeah, I love that he was like, I'm in love. No, you're not. And my great is Hild.
Oh, okay. Why?
Everybody needs a Hild.
Everybody needs a Hild.
Like, listen, lady. I love how she's like, he's a man of God. And I'm like, Hild, you just cut a guy's head off with a butter knife last episode. You need to check your priorities.
With a butter knife.
But I do love Hild. I loved the clip that you played in the beginning of this episode. I loved how, as you said, a lot of time and space has gone here. And this has gone from this nun who we met who just has continued to take charge of her life. I love seeing, there's a lot of things that we're going to talk about in regards to women, in regards to being property. I think in this episode, I think it's a really interesting foil. Not foil, but actually, just to be able to see actually the two in tandem, that Uhtred's in slavery and yet the king's sister, whatever her name is, Uhtred's current love, is Isla. Essentially a piece of, get some new names, people.
wait till we start talking about Ethelfled and Ethelred, who's going to be the new tandem.
Okay, the king's sister.
Rhyming names.
Gisela. Anyway, how Hild was able to help with Gisela, how Hild was able to have his sword, how Hild was like just straight up chilling with Ragnar, like, all right, here I am. That is a woman, that is a character, and I'm proud that it's a woman who has been able to take trauma and has been able to continue to push herself, even though it's difficult, and stands by her friends.
Sure.
So well done, Hild.
Sure. My good is...
She's like the Murta.
Oh, okay.
Like everybody needs a Murta. Everyone needs a Hild.
You know what? I think I'm in on this.
Yeah.
You know what, Mary? Yes.
Bam. Like she can come around my Thanksgiving table and like hang out with us. Like she's
she
a
can
solid.
Figure things out. You know, she's bringing
she's
all
the
great food.
She's got
she's bringing like that special like stuffing. You know, but she brings it with the cranberries and the nuts and everything. But usually when people bring that, it sucks.
Yeah.
But when Hild makes it,
it's great.
It's really
you're
good.
You're like, you all can bring whatever you want except Hild.
Yeah.
You know what you're bringing.
You bring that special stuffing.
Yep.
You know, with all the stuff in it. No, I'm a plain stuffing guy.
It's head cheese.
It's
isn't that what it is? Isn't oh no, is that something perverted?
That's what she said.
Oh, no.
I have no idea what
I'm just thinking like gross droppings from the head she cut off.
Oh.
Sorry if I just said something I shouldn't have.
No, you didn't, but it just when you're married to a 14-year-old boy, that's what happened.
Yes. Okay, so how about your GBG? Let's move on.
So my good was Alexander Draymond. I, as most of you know, and I know you know, Mary, I have not been an enormous fan of his acting.
Who is this?
This is Uhtred. This is one of the things that have kind of held me back from loving this show as opposed to like really enjoying it.
Okay.
Like, you know, and you know, we could almost call this Sam Heughan disease, where, you know, Sam Heughan in the first season of Outlander was not great, Bob. Just like not great. He was okay, but it wasn't great.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't really get into, I think, the
I mean,
whole...
I think that there were some great aspects, particularly in the fact that Jamie was a young man. And I think that that's the thing that we need to keep in mind with Uhtred. This is very much like loving and... I loved Sam. I loved Jamie. I loved Jamie.
Well, see,
even
well,
in his youth. Like, but that's the thing, is what I'm saying, is we're looking at two men who we do go over these grand swaths of time with their characters, and we get to see them evolve. Like, right now, as a 39-year-old woman, I'm not like, yay, I totally want to, like, hang out with a 22-year-old man who just wants to, like,
Uhtred,
go...
Uhtred is the guy that you date in your early 20s.
When that's your age,
Yeah, he dates and you date him in your early 20s. You go on the motorcycle with him. You make some bad choices with him. And then you move on.
Mm-hmm.
And then you move on to a jabroni like me. I'm going to call this Sam Heughan disease a little bit, where I was not in love with Sam Heughan. He was great towards the end of season one. And then he was much better with each progressive season. The same thing I'm going to say here with Alexander Draymond. I was not a huge fan of his in the first season. And I feel like he has played Uhtred pretty much the same the entire time.
Okay.
There has not been a whole ton of range from mm-hmm. Alexander Draymond. Though, in this episode, we get that. We get that in spades. And not only do we go from him being a slave, we go to him being a broken man where he can't even fight, you know, Idi Shay Sven. And then we go to him healing and being healed by Hild. And then we go to him being banana land crazy with Abbot Uhtred, which, by the way, loved. And if you go back and watch that scene, and this is why I'm saying this is my good. If you look at Alexander Draymond's eyes... when he's like, say she's married one more time. Like, the way that his eyes are.
Well, it's also eyeliner.
No, but it's just like. It's
no,
like,
but he went from, like, not having his makeup on, then he was like, I'm back. Hand me my charcoal eyeliner.
I felt like I saw his entire iris.
Yes.
His whole eye.
He bug-eyed that.
The bug eye. And it was just like, it wasn't like stupid bug eye.
It was the opposite
of
smize. You know how like Tyra Banks has her smize, like smile with your eyes? It was like kill with your eyes.
Yes, absolutely. Oh, hold on 1 second. We made everything in our studio is just falling apart.
It's okay. It's okay. We're all right. We're hanging in there.
We're going to fix that.
So that was your great, right?
No, that was my good.
Oh man, took a long time just to say you're good.
Yeah, I know. Sorry.
Okay, let's.
All right, we're back in black here. Back in black. All right. The bad for me is I'm kind of out on Hild's reaction to killing Abbot Uhtred. She's like, yeah, you just, that's a man of God. You killed him. And she's sitting there mourning this guy.
I take it a little bit as a different way, as that's a man of God. You're in big trouble. Like, we just rescued you and we are going to be in big trouble. I don't think she cared for that guy. Yes, he was a man of God. So maybe there was a little bit of mutual respect. But now, knowing the repercussions that happened to Uhtred because of what he does, it's more like, that was a man of God. Like, you just did a major no-no.
Yeah. And maybe it was shock. And not necessarily like, oh, that this is a man of God who died. I mean, I'm sure there's a part of that that plays into it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was just kind of out on that reaction. She's like, because she saw how awful this guy was and what he was trying to do. You could say that, you know, in the background, Uhtred was, you know, he was playing... He was playing the ropes, and he was making things happen without being too out front. And if you wanted to say, well, you know, she only saw that, then okay, I understand the reaction. But she saw him straight up villain mode when she's trying to marry when he's trying to marry Gisela to Uncle Scar through his proxy.
Yes,
and he is truly poking at Uhtred.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't like that reaction. But my great, and it obviously goes back to Hild as well. It goes back to that scene with Hild and Uhtred that we played at the beginning of our episode. That healing scene is special. That is a scene that I will remember.
Agreed.
You know, I always try to talk about scenes in like, the first thing that you think of when you think of a show.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's Outlander or The Leftovers or anything that we've covered, Gilmore Girls, anything that we've covered, what's that one scene that you go back to and you're like, dude, that blew my doors off. Yeah, that's this scene so far.
Okay.
That was excellent. And it was the most subdued, perfect scene that showed everything that this show does well. Writing, directing, cinematography, acting, all of it. It was perfect. And I loved it. And not only that, but it's, she says to him, well, he says to her, I'm ashamed of what I've become. What that is, I'm not 100% sure, but regardless, he went from a warrior to a slave. And that must break him. And she says to him, it doesn't matter what you are. You are Uhtred, son of Uhtred, Lord of Bebbanburg. It's time you remembered that. Playing on this this theme of what is identity and how do you define your identity. So perfect. And that, my love, is my GBG.
That is that.
There we go.
That is that.
So what else stands out
to you? Going chronologically in this episode will be a big help. I will say, I need to get this off my chest. I'm not a big fan of the Gisela Uhtred situation, just because, like, sorry, Uhtred, you're a two-episode chump, okay? Two, three-episode. But like you said, this does span great deals of time. So maybe we just need to take Uhtred for his word, and say, okay, a lot of time did pass. Maybe he really does love Gisela, and maybe she really does care about him, and maybe this relationship will last a little longer. Maybe she'll just be dead, or maybe she'll leave him for somebody else. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen?
Yep.
Where's Brita?
Oh, good point. Oh, by the way, Mary, we have to play this for you. Hold on. Bam. Just like that. A winner. Because you called the slavery aspect of the show being wrapped up in one episode. I called it in two. Good job by you. I'm very proud of you.
I'm
as
glad.
Always great call.
Why, thank you.
Hey, and what did we put a sword in? What was the thing that we were supposed to talk about?
I wanted to talk about we put a sword in the fact that a lot of people say that this is the episode that makes them fall in love with the show.
Excellent, thank you so much. Actually, let's begin there. My question to you is, do you believe this? Like, is this the episode that puts this
I need to go on from here, but I would agree that this was a very powerful episode, that this was a wonderful episode in regards to some relationships, particularly between Uhtred and Hild. We get to see a lot of things starting to be in motion. We're back with Alfred, of course, having that connection with Uhtred. So that's in play. We've got Ragnar, who Uhtred is standing up for, and he's been looking for him for the better part of a year.
Yeah.
So I think in regards to the tightness of these relationships that we've been able to see from the very beginning, now it's really interwoven into this beautiful kind of braid of how they've been able to stay connected in each other's lives, but also what Uhtred goes through. This is Uhtred Uhtred at his lowest. We've seen him have beloved people be killed. We've seen his baby die. We've seen how he's been with the witch woman, Isolde, or whatever her name was. Don't burn the bread lady.
Don't you besmirch the good name of Isolde.
I already have, and I will continue to. Whatever, you're dead. I'm sorry.
Still, one of the hottest scenes in TV I've ever seen. Her looking at him when they first meet. Woof! Oh, goodness gracious.
I'm glad about that for you.
Send shivers up your spine.
So I'm just saying that I believe it. I believe when people say this is the episode that gets them fully entrenched, loving in these characters. I hope that they don't kill some of the characters that now I am really caring about and for these relationships to grow. That's where I'm at. I will say, if I could have made an editorial choice, yep, and it had I been in the writer's room and had I known that there was going to be both season one and season two, I would not have killed Lyra Frick in the final battle of season one.
Yes.
I would have saved him, and I would have had him have the dead guy's position. Halleck. Yeah. I would have had him be Halleck's role. I did not learn to love Halleck. I felt terrible for him in this episode. I felt terrible for him with his being, you know, going crazy on the ship and for everything that he's done by Uhtred's side. We've been able to see him grow kind of as a brother figure of Uhtred's. But had that been Lyra Frick, the pain that we would have felt as the viewers, seeing him lose his mind on the ship, seeing Uhtred care for him, and then feeling Uhtred's pain, hearing Lyra Frick's screams as he's tied to the bow of this ship, we, I think, as viewers would have felt it even more so. We still felt bad for that guy, but had this been Lyra Frick in that role, your minds would have been blown.
Mary?
A much better death for him.
Absolutely.
A much better mourning that we get to see as Uhtred, as our own viewers.
Yep. All around, you are 100%
should have been him.
Right. Should have been him. I still don't understand why they killed Lyra Frick in the first season. I get it. I don't like it. I thought it was a meaningless death. I thought it was done for the sake of doing it. And yes, you're right. If had they put Halleck or Lyra Frick in this space of Halleck's role, 100% would have been more impactful, more meaningful. The relationship between Uhtred and Lyra Frick would have been far more investing. Mm-hmm. And Mary, I think this kind of all plays into itself. There's one giant circle that's happening here. People have said that they mark this as the episode where this show kicks into high gear. And that happens for a couple of reasons, in my opinion. It's not because of the writing necessarily, or because of the direction, or the cinematography. It's all been great. I mean, again, that scene between Hild and Uhtred is bananas good. What matters, I think, is vulnerability. We finally have Uhtred be truly vulnerable. Mm-hmm. He began this series as a badass. And he continued to be a badass through and like you had certain things like his son's death or him losing certain people or Isolde's death, like, but those that fed into the badassery of Uhtred, right? That fed into that.
Mm-hmm.
This, what happens in this episode, it destroys that.
Mm-hmm.
And says, oh no, you think one thing, but we're gonna take that and we're gonna break him down into a whole nother thing.
Yeah.
And then they have to build him back up. They have to rebuild him. And that moment when he's sitting and touching the grass and the insect and just looking up at the sky. And
which, by the way, Blake nor I could lay in that grass for a day and a half. And nap and have all the little creeper bugs like stepping all over us.
Bugs and ants.
Are used to sleeping, though. I mean, think about it. He was used to sleeping on that ship in like a wet,
good
gross
point.
Thing.
Good
so
point.
This being like warm in grass is probably much more comforting to him.
Yeah. The fact of the matter is this. We finally have a vulnerable Uhtred. And we go from a place of being tortured, literally, to where we are now. And vulnerability is what makes characters relatable. It doesn't matter who you are, what you are, what you're doing, what character you are. You can be Batman, right?
Yeah.
But he has to have a vulnerability so that we can relate to that person.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we get here. And how normally do we get vulnerability? It's through relationships. And when those relationships are tested, or when they're put through a vice, that is when you get the true nature of a character, the choices that they make, and who they are as a character. That's when the characters start defining the direction that they're going, as opposed to the plot of where they're going. That is a huge, huge deal. And I bring it back to what you said about Leah Fritch, because that vulnerability would have been skyrocketing.
Agreed.
But I still felt bad for Halleck. I still felt bad.
The actor did a fine job. We all cared for him. We were able to see Uhtred. You know, the other thing with Halleck that is different than Leah Fritch. So Leah Fritch, of course, was a soldier of Otter's and of Alfred's. So that might have changed the situation in regards to him being sold as a seed. But also, Halleck was meeker. You know, he had a smaller frame. He almost looked younger in terms of Uhtred. So you did get to have kind of that big brother kind of sense that Uhtred would have over Halleck, where he may not have necessarily like nuzzled him and been like, here's some bread, if it was Leah Fritch.
Right. And you know, when Uhtred was going back to Halleck and saying, you've fought with me at Ethandun, you are a soldier, you're a warrior, just think what that would have felt like if that was Leah Fritch.
Yeah.
You know, just think of that. That's kind of where I want to leave it because I don't want to spend the whole episode talking about that, because we're not here to make a better show. I mean, I suppose. Yeah. But I do want to center some of the conversation around the slavery ship aspect of it. Did you buy all the CGI? Did you buy the water and the whole thing? And
there was only one moment where I didn't believe the CGI. It was where we see all the slaves in the ship and the slave owners. They're on the ship walking and they're heading towards Iceland. That was the only time that I was like, this isn't the best CGI.
Yeah.
But whatever. Whatever, man. I don't expect them to like rent boats and be out in the water and doing all this stuff. They did the best they could. I'm not going to nitpick over the CGI. I think that this is a beautiful show. And for that to be the one aspect that I don't think was their best, I doubt they're going to be spending loads of time at sea.
Yep. Yep. One of the things I think that keeps defining Uhtred too is how much he's losing. You know, he has lost Leah Fritch. He has lost Isolde. Now he's lost Halleck. These are people that have to live in his memory, and he also is subject to that. He has to live with the fact that he told Halleck, I'm going to get you out of here. Mm-hmm. You followed every single order that I've given you.
Yes.
Follow this one. We're getting out.
Yeah.
You know, did you buy the escape scene?
Yes, I did. Finally, they were on land. They felt comfortable. They probably, I believe, if they hadn't have tried to escape, I would have been very confused. I feel like Uhtred would most certainly have been trying to find a reason to escape and a time to escape.
Sure. Another thing that I want to ask you if you bought too was the inclusion of Finnan, the new friend that's come. Where
he's hot. I'll take him.
That's what she said. I'll take
him. Did you buy the friendship? Did you buy the whole did you buy the whole thing of, you know, we have a bond?
Yes.
You know, I think,
what did he say, we have a bond?
Yes.
We are bonded. And I liked that because it made me think of the chains.
Yes, absolutely.
So
perfect.
I loved that was the word that he chose. You know, are you brothers? We are bonded. Like,
and that's that kind of goes back to the whole, this show plows through its timeline.
Mm-hmm.
Because all of a sudden we are thrown into Uhtred being a slave on this ship, and we are all of a sudden just supposed to buy that the guy behind him and the guy in front of him, they're all best friends now. And Finnan is the guy behind him, Halleck being the guy in front of him.
Yeah. I mean, we believed the Finnig part, and then this guy was behind him, and they would kind of buddy up. So
right.
I believed it.
Yep.
I didn't have a problem with it.
I love that Finnan, you know, told the guy that I'm going to kill you, and he does.
And he does.
And he does.
Agreed.
And I will never hear the word pull again and think of it just normally. That is, again, a Marion Blake media commandment. Give me a good bookend. Give me a good bookend so that you know you're in safe hands.
Yep.
You know that whoever is writing, whatever we're doing here, they got a plan.
Mm-hmm.
And when you begin the episode with pull and you end the episode with a far greater pull.
Yes.
And just the emotional release of what happened, you're damn right that is where I want to go. Yeah. And I was happy that it was in Finnan's hands as opposed to Uhtred, who was essentially a broken mess.
Yes.
And of course, you leave it to Idi Shay Sven to see, like, pick up the sword and fight me. Mary, your thoughts on that scene and Idi Shay Sven.
I loved that because I do believe that he would have done that. He does want to be the one to behead and slay Uhtred. Who cares if he's so weak that he can't do anything? That's how bad Idi Shay Sven is that he would do that. He would try to kill a man as he's down, and he is in no shape or form even a shadow of the warrior that he used to be. What was weird is how quickly that group got ran out by Ragnar's people.
Oh,
it was
yeah.
like... I didn't understand how they found out so quickly. You know, we saw the slave trader.
Yeah.
And at first he was approached by Ragnar, and he says they come usually in the spring
yes.
on the full moon or whatever. And then Idi Shay Sven comes, and he's like, I want to know where Uhtred is too. So he obviously tells him. I don't know who told Sven, and I don't know who told Ragnar. Like, did one kid go tell Sven? Did one? Or it seemed like Sven was there. It seemed like Sven was camped out, like, I'm going to be here until Uhtred comes back. But then how did Ragnar know just to show up?
Well, my sense is that Idi Shay Sven killed the I can't remember the guy's name. It was like...
The slave seller?
Yeah, the slave seller. Like, okay. His name was like Rorik or something. I can't remember. Okay. Be it with an R. I know that. I feel like he killed the guy.
Okay.
And Ronus. I think his name is Ronus.
I mean, that's a name.
I know. He killed him and then just waited where he would be normally.
Mm-hmm.
My other sense, too, is that Ragnar and company were also camping out, waiting, knowing that is where Ronus
And just waiting was. For, like, the ship to come
and
in?
And waiting for the ship to come in.
Okay.
And, you know, perhaps they sent somebody every single day to go just check
just
it out.
Just to peek,
you
yes.
know, just to peek, make sure. Okay. You know, because you got to think, the...
Yeah, it could happen at any time.
Happen at any time, and they got to get the boat in. They got to get the anchor down. They got to make sure they get all the slaves off the ship. There's a lot of time in between there, so it would make sense for one person to be there, camped out, looking, going back to the group, and the group now heading over to kill Idi Shay Sven.
Yes,
but the guy won't die.
No,
he just keeps getting away.
I love it.
Oh, what a clown! What a clown.
I love it. I love it for the story. So I'm here if he keeps living for a little while longer. We have to be, you know, Ragnar reminds us that their sister is still lost.
Yes.
You know, he's able to remind him, like, we have all these other things that we have to do, but my one job was to bring you back to Alfred.
Yes.
And really upstanding, Ragnar. Really, really upstanding. As I said, I'm interested to know where Breida is. As Alfred kind of throws that in, you know, Ragnar and Breida are supposed to be free, but they won't be if you don't take the fall for this and come back into my army.
My guess is Breida is still in chains,
jail?
And making sure that Ragnar does what he is supposed to do.
Like, hopefully they're feeding her a little better. Hopefully now that the queen got her glow up and she's a little friendlier, they're giving her, like, some nice food, maybe a thing of soap every once in a while. Because Ragnar looks happy, right? In that horse, living La Vida Loca.
He's living his life.
Yes, he is.
He is out there. This is like a bachelor party.
It is.
I'm not with my girl. I get to do whatever the hell I want.
I mean, I don't think he's, like, sleeping around like Uhtred.
No. Ragnar strikes me as a guy that is
one and
very
done.
Faithful.
Yes.
One and done. But he's out there. You know, it's like when it's kind of like the pandemic. You've been stuck in your house for an entire year, mm-hmm. and you want to go out and you do things, and they tell you, okay, masks off, everybody. And you're like, let's go to the bar. You know,
I mean,
and
we
that's
weren't.
What Ragnar is.
That's what we think the 22-year-olds were like.
Yeah.
But
hot girl summer. That's what it is.
That's what it was, except we
Ragnar,
didn't.
It was.
We were like,
hot
let's
Ragnar
put in
summer.
Our fence that we've been looking forward to buying and stay in our own backyard some more.
Oh, yeah, that is very true.
This is what happens when you have kids.
Pathetic and true. But it's hot Ragnar summer. That's what it is. And that is how I feel, you know, he is going. Mm-hmm. Also, when Uhtred sees Ragnar for the first time.
Oh, my gosh.
He has that, like, little squeak of Ragnar. Like, that also, it could have been played so differently.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of reminded me of that movie Captain Phillips. I don't think you watched that with me.
I did not.
Tom Hanks plays the Captain Phillips, the guy that was on the oil tanker or the ship that was taken hostage by the Somalian pirates.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Captain Phillips, as Hanks as Captain Phillips, keeps it all together the entire time. And finally, when, you know, the U.S. military comes in and rescues these guys. Hanks, he gets on the military ship, and the first step that he takes, he just completely breaks. Like, mm-hmm. after all of the trouble, after everything that he's gone through, he just breaks, and he starts crying, and he breaks down after being so strong the entire time. And that's the one, again, that one scene that I think of when I think of that movie. I watched the whole thing. I don't even remember half of it, but I remember that. Because why, Mary? Vulnerability.
There we go.
Vulnerability. Let's talk a little bit about the other portion of this episode. We have a lot of the plot mechanics
Alfred
happening
Peeps
with Alfred
dinner.
And Uhtred and the
Ethelwald princess.
And then Ethelred. Ethel fled.
Whatever. Soon to be prince.
Soon to be. No, Ethel fled as the princess. Whatever. And soon to be married to Ethelred.
Oh, God.
After Wolf Chair, or Chair Wolf,
Where are they from? Mersa?
Mercia.
Mercia.
Yeah.
Isn't Mersa like a disease?
Mersa's a disease. Okay.
So essentially, like the Prince of Mercia,
yes.
We'll just call him, and Alfred's daughter, the princess.
Yes. Okay. I'm not sure if he is a prince
I'm
of Mercia.
I'm just calling him that. He's
but yeah,
not.
Might as well be.
He's like a lord
you know
it.
What? Stats are for nerds.
The cute guy from Mercia.
Yeah, sure. Watching Chair Wolf croak, that was good.
Yeah.
That guy just showed up, started making demands of swords and everything, and that was it.
Swords. Oh. I loved that guy.
Your cousin,
you know,
from Boston.
Blake and I frequently talk about what we're going to be like when we're much older, and it is something that I look forward to because I feel like when you're that old, you have zero Fs to give, and you just say what is on your mind. Like, no, I'm not going to come and just like talk about the weather and eat a little bit of your food, and then we'll eventually get to this. Like, I know what you want. I know you want me to have a young man who's going to marry your princess. I'm here to tell you what I want. I'm pretty much the Spice Girls. Tell you what I want, what I really, really want. And Alfred's like, so tell me what you want, what you really, really want. I'll tell you what I want, except I'm dead.
I'm dead.
Point was made.
Point was definitely made. And
then the queen going over and just getting the paper. So who's the hot prince?
Yeah, who's this guy?
Who's
Call
nice.
It out for me, will you?
And then you see the princess look, and she gives this look like, chicka, wow, wow.
Yeah,
and Alfred's like, oh my gosh, my daughter's down. She's down to get married because it's a hot guy. I'm here for this.
Ethelfled is down. She is DTF.
Can you help me with something?
Sure.
Why does Alfred want her to marry someone from Mercia?
Because it's part of the northern borders.
Mm-hmm.
But doesn't he already own it?
He says it's part of England still.
Yes, but the problem that Alfred has is that he is trying to make this England. But not everybody else is buying into it. And that is why Chaelwulf is perfect. Because he's saying, no. Yeah. You could say all you want about this England thing. But you're Wessex and I'm Mercia. And you are your own king and I am my own king.
I'm your buffer. I have the Danes keep coming at me all the time.
And you're the one who agreed to make Daneland. What makes you so powerful that you can do it? F you. And that is the important part of what this all plays into. He, Alfred, wants Ethelfled to be married off to somebody so that he can guarantee that she will produce a line mm-hmm. that will be related to him.
Okay.
And that she will be guaranteed lands in Mercia. It's not just about the bride price being 3,000 pieces of silver.
No.
Whatever. Who cares? Oh, yeah. Four? Yes. Doesn't matter.
He doesn't even need that money.
I want something more. I want something more permanent. That is lands. And if she has lands in Mercia, that means Alfred's influence now goes into those lands. He has a legal claim to those lands, which then expands his idea of England.
Cool.
So that is the reason why... they created the marriage. And then we also have, of course, the falling apart of this little triumvirate that was made between Uhtred and Uncle Scar and the brothers. You can kind of tell that the brothers knew that Uhtred was a clown because they were like, yeah, I guess Uhtred ain't dead. And it's good to see you, Alfred. Have a good ride back. It's gonna be a long walk.
What? What jerks? Yeah. What kind of brothers are these? And what was his master plan? Because now he's dead. I mean, I feel a little weird because it was almost anticlimactic. We knew that this, the bad brother, the like lead yeah. one, we the one who was like, I had the vision. We knew that he had some motives, but like, what was your plan, man? Because now you just created this massive mess. Then you tried to marry
Uhtred. Uhtred created the mess. Well, no, Uhtred created the mess too.
Yeah. It was him because Uhtred's just the puppet.
Yeah, but I think Uhtred wanted Uhtred dead. Uhtred was the one that said, no, put him in slavery.
No, exactly. I'm saying I don't know what Uhtred's final goal really was, aside from just to like get their land stable and to kind of have, you know, a stronger fortress or who knows what with all these people. I really don't know what he was getting at, but he obviously was the puppet master with Uhtred being the puppet.
Yes.
Uhtred just kind of messed up because he has a soft heart. And he's like, oh, rather than him die, he can just go away into slavery. It'll be fine. Nobody will know, except Uncle Scar does know.
And Uncle Scar has probably the best line of the whole episode. All I required was one lifeless head. What are we doing? For 200 spears.
That's it.
Are you out of your mind?
This
was easy. By the way, the chairs that they were all sitting in, the most uncomfortable chairs that I've ever seen in my life. You don't know, it kind of reminds me of Men in Black. You remember that scene when they're all taking the test?
Yes.
And like they're sitting in like these little eggs and they don't know how to. Right on the
to
test.
Me, because also Alfred has a couple of chairs that he's had, and I'm like, that doesn't look comfortable at all. But maybe it was just so bougie that they were like, this is my bougie chair, and I spent a lot of money, and it took, you know, it's like pretty, but not comfortable whatsoever. But it shows your wealth. Like even the cups that they're drinking out of when Uncle Scar is there talking with Uhtred, you know, it almost reminded me of like I don't know, it was like a beaker. It was like a bowl type of bottom and swirls at the top. And it almost looked like a mason jar, like you could kind of screw a top on it.
Yep.
But in my mind, I'm like, no, that's to show that it took like more time and effort and that's a little pretty. And this is their pretty cups that they took out for him because this is like the elite business meeting in their bougie chairs with their bougie cups.
Yeah.
But of course, he ends up saying, okay, I'll marry Gisela, even though you didn't give me Uhtred's head, fine. And all that it took was for the maniacal puppet master brother to say she likes Uhtred and Uhtred likes her.
Right.
So even though we didn't give you his head, we can give you his heart.
Guy's playing 4D chess.
Yes.
Until he ain't anymore.
And it was when so he sees quick. Uhtred. Yeah. So of course that was a quick comes flip. In, takes his you know, takes the now kind of wife. I mean, she is technically
I mean,
married.
I suppose.
I don't know what the rules were back then.
Listen, if the guy's dead, there ain't nobody there to say that she's married to him.
Well, the other brother who was still alive, the taller, skinnier brother with the beard,
brother
and then
True,
the proxy.
Yeah, the proxy's there. I don't know. I still feel
I think that he could get into some trouble with this because she may be still technically legally married.
Is this a Destined to Be Theory of the Week?
Yes.
Oh, look at you. Okay, there it is. Hold on. Let's make this official. Hold on.
Gisela technically law-wise being married, even though they hadn't bedded yet, I think that Uhtred's going to run into
a problem.
Do you
think this is going to be a problem of Alfred's that he's going to have to deal with?
Yeah. Alfred will be like, okay, so you did me that solid, but now you've been banging this married woman.
Yeah, and you know he's not afraid to take advantage of Uhtred because he's got Uhtred
even
now.
Even though Uhtred hooked him up with so much.
Yeah. He's still now playing Uhtred into his hands, saying, no, you're going to be my guy.
Yeah.
That's
and
it.
And here's how I'm going to blackmail you.
And, you know, but before we end the show, I do want to say, again, this episode was all over the place, but in a good way.
Yeah.
And even though I wanted it to be spread out over more time, in addition to the vulnerability, part of that, for everything that is vulnerable and bad, you have to have an offset, and that is humor, a sense of humor. And we've talked about some of the lines that are humorous, but one of the other lines that happens in this show is Ragnar showing up and being like, Uhtred, I'm bored of this. Just kill everybody. Kill them all.
Yeah.
Ragnar quickly becoming one of my favorite characters.
I'm right there with you.
That was a great line, and I just love that he just has zero Fs. His Fs account is on overdraft.
Agreed.
And I like that he just showed up and said, let's kill everybody.
Oh, and how he was like, you didn't think that we would abandon you, that we'd forget about you.
Yeah.
Okay, I love Father Bjorka, and I love Ragnar.
Yeah. Is it the eye makeup, do you think? No. Are you in on the eye makeup?
The forehead tattoo. That's what I'm here for.
Because
the eye makeup on Uhtred just makes me think he's trying to be Johnny Depp in Pirates of the Caribbean.
Good point. But what about Ragnar? I mean, he's got some thick.
I mean, he's always had it, though. I haven't really seen him without it. So.
All right. Fair enough. Anything else you want to talk about in this episode?
No, that's it.
Oh, one other thing. Lastly, I want to mention.
Yeah.
We have not yet mentioned this, and I've been meaning to for the past two episodes. Mm-hmm. You can tell that the coloring and the lighting in this season is far different than the first season. It is far more colorful.
Yes.
And it feels cleaner, more...
I like it a lot.
Yeah, I like it better than the first season.
I like the visual
season.
Aspect much better.
The first season, while very pretty, mm-hmm. seemed more muddy, if you know what I mean.
Yes.
This feels much cleaner. It feels much more precise. Mm-hmm. And that's something I think we can get into in another couple episodes.
Yeah.
But I like where the visual language of the show and where it's going and how all that goes to be. One other thing too, sorry. They are clearly setting up, I think, seasons worth of characters.
Yes.
Ethel Fled, Ethel Red.
Oh my God. Ethel, please just call them their nicknames.
Yeah, Prince and Princess.
Princess.
Ethel Wald is still around.
The drunk guy.
Drunk guy.
Drunk
and he's laughing. He couldn't even contain himself. He was great. But
he's here for it.
There's, you know, Gisela. They're setting up this posse. They're adding Finn into the posse now, to the Uhtred posse. You can see that they're moving
new
pieces.
Hot guy. Okay.
The new hot guy. They're moving pieces to get us a real cast that will be around for a while.
Yeah.
And that's the smart choice. And that all really takes place this episode. So I'm in.
Me too.
All right. Get any other Destined to Be theories of the week?
No, that all was right. it.
Well, I got
I already
one.
Gave myself.
All right. So we're going to have to deal with this whole Siegfried and Eric thing. And you know that Guthred's going to have to answer for what he has done. Because now, as much as it is hard for us to accept that Uhtred is back within the clutches of Alfred, that isn't wholly a bad thing. I know we want Uhtred to go get Bebbanburg and
be
his own man.
I don't.
I think a lot of people do. But I think it's a good thing. And now Uhtred has real power. Underneath Alfred.
I just don't know the shape that Bebbanburg's going to be in, if the people are even going to want him to be their leader. I'm kind of like, listen, man, why don't you just get your own plot?
Well, Bebbanburg is going to be fine because Uncle Scar, Aelfrich, he's taking care of everything.
Yeah, but are they going to want to work for him? You know, it's like when you get a new job
yeah,
and the people like
point.
The other person.
That's
it's
a good
a little
point.
Awkward for 3 years.
What was the...
That's what they say is when you get a new job.
What was the Devil Wears Prada?
Emily.
Emily.
Yeah.
You're the new Emily.
You're the new Emily. Exactly.
Uhtred is going to be the new Emily.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. So, we're going to have to deal with Eric and Siegfried. This is going to be a whole thing. And Guthred is going to have to, I think, answer to Alfred at mm-hmm. this point now. And I wonder if that is going to be the overarching narrative for the rest of the season. Especially because now I thought Uhtred was going to be the guy, the Abbot Uhtred was going to be the guy
the
overall bad guy. Obviously, he's not going to be now. Okay. I wonder if this whole confrontation is going to be it now.
With who?
Between Guthred, Aelfrich, and now
too many people.
Alfred. So I wonder if that's going to be the...
Who's Aelfrich?
Aelfrich is Uncle Scar.
Okay, just use their nicknames for me for a little bit. Or you can say both. Aelfrich, a.k.a. Uncle Scar.
Uncle Scar, drunk guy. Not drunk guy. Now you're getting me confused.
Uncle Scar, Guthred. Alfred, and Guthred.
Yes.
I got that.
Okay, so I wonder if that's going to be the whole... And they're going to have to deal with Siegfried and Eric, the two Danish brothers.
Oh my God, I just see them joining whoever wins. I see them being like, Ragnar, can we hang with you?
No, I think after all this pillaging and everything that they went back to after the whole triumvirate was gone, they're going to have to get their butts handed to them. And I think that's going to happen. They're going to have to do that
Danes
soon.
Danes do, man.
All right. So that is that. I would say probably one of my favorite episodes of this show so far.
Same.
And that's that. All right, let's close it out, shall we?
Yeah. Thank you all all so incredibly much for tuning in to The Last Kingdom with Mary and Blake. As I said in the beginning of this podcast episode, if you enjoy Blake and I as podcast hosts, we have a slew of other topics that we cover. We've got Outlander, we've got Harry Potter, we've got Game of Thrones, Gilmore Girls, The Leftovers, one of our favorite shows of all time. So if you are in the mood to kind of start to binge some other shows, we got the colder months coming on in, you might be watching some things on Netflix or Stars or HBO, we have got you covered.
Definitely football weather out there right now. I am happy. Let's go. We have a goal to get 1,000 members at jointhenerdclan.com. Right now, we are at 840. And if we are able to get 1,000 members, we can buy a new computer. So, and that will help us produce better shows, more fluid shows, and our studio won't be falling apart. So, please, if you want to support Mary and I, an independent little podcast company that is not related to any of these big corporate entities, please go to jointhenerdclan.com, become a member there, get all the great extra stuff that is there, and help us get a new computer, because that is a big deal that we're going to need it. So that is destined to be. And if you want to get in touch with Mary and I, you can reach us at maryandblakemedia@gmail.com or reach out to us on any of the major social media platforms. And as much as I hate to admit it, including TikTok.
Yes, we're there. Just search Mary and Blake. We'll be the Mary and Blake that you find and see. We'd love to connect with you there. All right, my friends, on that note, my name is Mary.
My name is Blake.
Destiny is all.